प्रोफेसर डॉक्टर नितिन करमळकर, we are indeed honored by the presence and the discourse of Professor Karmalkar, the Vice Chancellor of the Savitribai Phule Pune University, which is being held here as the fifth lecture in the Professor Vaman Keshav Lele series of lectures. I request Professor Shrikant Pahulkar, the Honorary Secretary of the Institute, to welcome Professor Karmalkar with a token of gratitude and a bouquet. Professor Karmalkar is being presented with the latest issue, 93rd volume of the Annals of the Bhandarkar Institute. And I request the Honorary Secretary, Professor Pahulkar, to introduce the speaker of today, as also the person in whose name the lecture series has been established.
Friends, it gives me immense pleasure to welcome today's speaker, Professor Nitin Karmalkar, Vice Chancellor of the Savitribai Phule Pune University, and you all at this August gathering for the fifth Professor W.K. Lele Memorial Lecture, being annually arranged by the Bhandarkar Oriental Research Institute. First, I would like to speak a few words about Professor Lele, who is a great scholar of Sanskrit and Marathi, and who has spent almost most part of his life in Varanasi. Dr. Vaman Keshav Lele, he was born in 1933 and passed away in 2007, had his education in the University of Mumbai and in Pune. Basically, he was a Sanskrit scholar. But later on, he also started teaching Marathi, and I know from my personal experience and conversations on several occasions with him that he, while pursuing his studies in Sanskrit, also got interested in Marathi literature and Marathi poetics. He was a lecturer at Wadia College for some time, but later on he moved to Varanasi and taught Marathi in the Banaras Hindu Vishwavidyalaya until his retirement in 1993. It was a coincidence that I met him in Varanasi in 1993 when I joined the Central Institute of Tibetan Studies in Sarnath on the very day he was winding up and he was preparing for going back to Pune after his retirement. He was a very serious scholar and also a serious person, and he would not like cutting jokes and would not appreciate mostly any jokes, but sometimes I was an exception. I remember that he was appointed as an advisor for PhD at the Tilak Maharashtra Vidyapit, the Sanskrit department, where he supervised a dissertation And at the time of Viva was, I said that the subject of the dissertation, Vamana, a scholar of poetics, and also the supervisor is also Vamana. And I thought that he would not like it, but he added to that, and also one of the examiners was Vamana, Vama Kulkarni. From 1960 to 2005, he has written 30 research books in Marathi, Hindi, and also in English. Several of his research works have been awarded honors. He got some 20 awards for his books, and before he passed away, he worked on several projects, one of which was Marathi Hindi Vakya Kosha, which was completed before he passed away. As I said, he was a very good scholar, and we felt proud in establishing the endowment lecture in his sacred memory. Today's speaker, Professor Nitin Karmalkar, is known to you all, but by way of some formalities, I would like to introduce him. After having spent many years at the university and passing every phase of his life from being a student to heading departments and playing several other administrative roles at the university, Professor Karmalkar has been appointed the Vice Chancellor, the highest and prestigious academic administrative position at the university. This appointment means higher and more responsibilities and a challenge to take the university to higher and higher status. Professor Karmalkar has spent some 32 years at the Savitribai Phule Pune University, starting from 1982 as a student. He did his PhD from the Department of Geology at the university and his postdoctoral research from Sydney and Germany. He was the head of the Department of Geology and was also heading the Department of Environment Sciences before he took over as the Vice Chancellor. He was also the director of the Internal Quality Assurance Cell at the university and coordinator of the University for the Rashtriya Uchchatar Shiksha Abhiyan, a union government scheme. He also worked as the coordinator of the NAC committee, and as a result of his vision and coordinating skills, the university has recently achieved the reaccreditation by winning 3.6 out of 4 credits. As a teacher and a scholar, Professor Karmalkar has made significant contribution to his field of interest. He is known as an excellent teacher and has supervised 11 MSc dissertations, 4 PhD theses, and is currently supervising 5 more PhD theses. Since 2001, Professor Karmalkar has completed 6 outstanding research projects, and he has been engaged in collaborative research activities with several institutes and universities in India and abroad. For contributions in the field of alkaline magmatism of the Kutch region, Gujarat, Professor Karmalkar was awarded in 2005 the prestigious Professor C. Naganna Gold Medal of the Mineralogical Society of India. In Mysore. His varied research interests has perhaps motivated him to study the Harappan civilization, doing research in several places in Himalayas, in Ladakh, and Dhaulavira, and now to deliver a talk today on sanitation and water distribution system during the Harappan era. We, the members of the Bhandarkar Institute consider ourselves fortunate to have a great scientist like him to deliver today's talk. I welcome him and all of you once again and request him to begin his lecture. Thank you.
Good evening to you all. First of all, let me thank the organizers from the Bhandarkar Oriental Research Institute for giving me this opportunity to come here and make small presentation. I am grateful to Bhandarkar sir and other friends of mine. Basically, many of them are from geology community. And first of all, in the beginning, I pay my homage to Professor W. K. Lele, about whom Bhandarkar sir has already given great details. So with this small introduction, how in the first place I got involved into these activities, let me make a little sort of a clarification on that. You have understood from my bio data that I am not a person dealing with archaeology, neither with ancient science. I do work on ancient rocks, but ancients basically in millions of years. We geologists normally speak in terms of millions and billions of years. And therefore, compared to the geological time scale, what I'm going to speak is a very recent phenomenon. So, as a free geologist working in the area of Himalaya, especially starting mostly in the Tibetan Plateau, that is the Hanle region, and coming down to into the east, western part, almost up to Dras and Kargil. So all along that belt, actually, couple of visits, not couple, in fact, since 1984 onwards, for my PhD work initially, and then later on, basically, on various research projects that I handled, wherein I was trying to understand about, basically, the origin of Himalaya and various other aspects of the Himalayas. But during that particular course, many times I got an opportunity to look at various different heritage sites, you can call them. And then this continued almost up to say around 93. And beyond that, then it became so difficult to make it to Himalaya because of the geopolitical reasons. And my journey to a great extent got stopped there. So then I thought of switching over to another area with similar kind of rock types exposed. And then that turned out to be the Rana of Kutch. And it is known for other sites also, especially from the point of view archaeological site, the Dholavira region. So wherein basically my concentration used to be more on geological aspect, but you cannot ignore certain things of so importance which are within the vicinity of your field area. So I visited many of them. And that's how it got interested in, I got interested into these areas, being a student of geology. So I know, pretty sure you know better than me about Harappan era. I'm going to speak more about here, basically, what impressed me as a geology student, as such. Because subsequent to the work on various different kinds of rock types, I also been working as an environmental scientist, heading the environmental science department in the University of Pune, wherein actually we are looking for water resources, various different aspects of water, and from that point of view, whatever that has appealed me, that is I'm going to present in front of you.
Many of my friends actually rather forced me that we must visit Bhandarkar Institute. And in fact, it is a pleasure to be a part of this particular association. Day before yesterday, that is on 9th basically, there is an oath ceremony. The oath was actually given by MHRD, and we performed that at the university, wherein plenty of good things were spoken about, because we are completing 75 years of Challenge of China, and then 70 years of independence also. And in that, basically, another 7-8 days we'll be observing in memory of that particular event, and wherein it is recommended by the MHRD to visit our historical sites. So for me, Bhandarkar Institute is one such historical site of historical significance, so I did not miss this opportunity. When they told me, I said, readily agreed that we'll engage some sort of a talk. It's not a lecture, it's more of an interaction that I intend to have with you. Next. Okay. So, about the Indus Valley, you all are familiar with. It is basically bordering Pakistan, India, and Afghanistan. And all along the stretch, basically, there are certain areas which are mostly highlands, wherein actually you get to see the ruins of these various sort of ancient civilizations, where they've been identified as Harappan, Mohenjo-daro, and Dholavira. There are plenty, actually, about 1,500 such small or big sites been excavated as such. And basically, the geology and geography point of view, this is an interesting area, because most of the civilization was on the banks of River Indus. And River Indus, which originates and passes through Himalayan part, Himalayan are the youngest mountain chain. And these water, this is a perennial water source, basically because of the melting of glaciers. And there is a continuous water supply that's been happening out there. And then all along the Indus, basically, you have a rich, fertile silt zone. And probably that must have been the reason why most of this civilization, because of water as well as the fertile land closely available, most of these sites were civilization probably had was established. Next. So if you look at basically the chronology as such, by 3300 BC, small villages are established in the area around Mohenjo-daro. 2600 BC, buildings of planned cities begin at Mohenjo-daro. Then 2600 and 1800 BC, Mohenjo-daro is a thriving trade city. And by 1800 BC, basically there is a decline that began. And then Mohenjo-daro ruins were found in 1922. 1948, the first attempts to conserve Mohenjo-daro are made. 1973 plans got approved, and in 1980, these sites were declared as World Heritage Sites. Next. So basically, the history of Harappan civilization, the civilization lived in the valley about 4,000 years ago. Between 2600 and 1900 BC, basically, it was the most evolved kind of a civilization, with proper sort of town planning, proper governance, proper water distribution system, then sanitation, health, hygiene, everything was taken care of. So it was much evolved kind of a civilization that existed in this particular part. This was discovered by numerous scientists and archaeologists in 1921. Many different artifacts have been uncovered in the Indus Valley main cities, Mohenjo-daro and Harappa. They are called as cities. The population used to be to the tune of about 30,000 to 35,000. So, and accordingly, to accommodate such a large population, the construction and everything had taken place. In fact, the very, very evolved and developed sort of a brick system, generation and production of bricks that we see today also, the beginning was made during this particular part. Next. So this is about basically the Punjab region of Pakistan wherein these sites are exposed, the Harappa on the branch of Ravi River, Riva River, which is a branch of basically Indus. And then you have the other site located, and they are to an extent the tributaries of the Indus River. And these are various different sites where the excavation has been done, the Riva and Bias River basically, from where most of the information is coming. Next. In fact, there are incidences and evidences in favor that there used to be a transport happening between the Harappan and Mohenjo-daro almost to the extent of Nile River, crossing over the Arabian Peninsula, especially all along the Euphrates River. You can see, in fact, there is a trade that happened all along this particular arrow, and that is through the Persian Gulf. And evidences in favor, actually, you get it from places like Lodhal. Lodhal has a dockyard wherein you can get to see there are places created wherein they used to an extent park their ships, from where basically the journey is to take place. Next. So this is the evidence basically. This seal found in Mesopotamia indicates a product was made in Harappa, indicating trade took place between the two regions, the Euphrates, which is part of the Mesopotamian basically culture, and the Harappan culture. So there was trade happening, and there are very good evidences in favor. In fact, the pottery to a great extent, from the geological point of view, Professor Rajguru is sitting over here, and he is my mentor. I did spend a year at the Archaeological Institute at Deccan College, wherein he has actually introduced me to the importance of archaeology, wherein I remember that we had done the XRD studies of the potteries recovered in certain areas, and from that you can understand where from the soil was used to make that particular pottery asset. So to an extent you can find out where exactly the industry continued or evolved, and where it got perished and how it got transported. So there are just not notional sort of evidences, but in fact there are scientific evidences. There is work that has been put in to prove it, that some of the pottery which actually was recovered from the Mesopotamia had the soil origin coming from the Harappan part in the Punjab region. So there is a transportation of pottery that did take place as such. So as early as 2300 BC, the Harappan traded with the people of Tigris Euphrates Valley. Next. These are basically the in maps showing you the locations as well as the kind of town planning that got involved into in creating these two major cities. The first one is a normal map, and the second is a digital elevation model, making use of the GIS, showing basically the elevation difference. So most of these cities were situated on mounds, so as to basically avoid any kind of flooding. When the rivers especially have excess water, it should not disturb the civilization. So from that point of view, although they were on the banks of the river, but they have made use of all mounds or plateau areas which are slightly at an elevated sort of a region. Next. So the foundations of Harappan society, the Indus River. Why Indus River? I already explained. Silt and rich water from mountain ranges. Major society built by Dravidian people between 3000 to 2500 BC. Cultivation of cotton before 5000 BC. In fact, they practice a very proper and evolved kind of an agriculture also. And cultivation of cotton began almost 5000 BC. Early cultivation of poultry also. There are records coming from this plot. And the decline basically has been seen to be somewhere around 1900 BC. Major cities include Harappa, which is in the Punjab region, and Mohenjo-daro, which is at the mouth of Indus River. 70 smaller sites are excavated. Total sites excavated were to the tune of about 1500.
It was estimated that over the period, Harappa had grown to approximately 150 hectares of land. So one small township basically used to be covering this much of area. So next. Harappan culture spread all over the Indus Valley region, right, starting from basically almost not in the cold desert. Cold desert is basically your Dras and Karagil region, where the temperatures during the winter are very severe, in the sense to the tune of about minus 34 to minus 50 degrees centigrade, which are not supported to any kind of a civilization. People still live there, but during winter basically there is a migration that takes place. So most of it seems to be basically in the plateau region, that is the Tibetan side, towards the mouth of the Indus River, and then when you get into the Thar Desert, there are certain locations. So from that point of view, if you look at those areas geographically, if you look at, they are water deficient. There is not much of a rain. Rain is in the tune of say around 700 millimeter to as low as 100 millimeters. And therefore probably we will be spending more time on that. They created many water reservoirs wherein they could basically store the waters and use them properly. Next. So this is the basically rails which indicates a very planned kind of a structure. These were very planned cities. Indians create plumbing and sewage system. These were so developed comfortable and hygienic lifestyles as manifested by efficient sewage system, bathrooms and flushing toilets, which can be compared to the modern wastewater system of today. In fact, for this comparison, what is being seen in some of the areas, which are again the Himalayan part, today also, I am going to show you some pictures which are distinctly different but comparable to what has been used during the Harappan times. Next. So city built on mud brick platform to protect against floodwaters, as I already mentioned, at an elevated sort of a plateau region. Brick walls protect city and citadel. So especially if there is a heavy flooding, then in the central part there used to be a place where all the villagers can move and they can get protected from the excess flood water. Then streets and grid systems are 30 feet wide, so there used to be a cart moving in those streets, and mostly bullock carts. Sometimes even there are evidences that there are made use of elephants to carry those carts. So both the things were present. Lanes separate rows of houses which feature bathrooms. Next. And these are some of the pictures. You can see that's the picture of Mohenjo-daro, and you can see the citadel in the central part, that tower kind of thing that you are looking at. So wherein people can gather during the flood part, and they can to an extent get saved themselves from the excessive water. This is a great bath, and this is the reservoir that I was speaking about. And entirely made of bricks is a proper construction. In fact, on the floor, in some places you get to see a coating of tar so that the water doesn't percolate down, it gets stored there. And then to empty this particular reservoir, there is a proper sort of a hole from where the entire water can be removed as such. And these are basically the system that is present over here in the rains. And you can look at the streets. So some of them are small, but some of them quite big, wherein there used to be a bullock cart transport happening. Next. Perhaps these are some of the most ancient wells, which they knew even about the dug wells, how to basically excavate water or exploit water, the groundwater system basically. So in fact, very well developed river system, and then actually if you get into the deeper part, in fact there is a proper sort of transportation underneath the ground basically. That is also been in certain areas can be seen as such. So public wells supply the water and bathrooms used in advanced drainage system. The careful structure of these cities showed that this civilization had a well organized government. So governance is another important aspect of this particular sort of civilization. Next. So the first planned city you can call it to the Mohenjo-daro between 2500 to 1300 BC along the Indus River Valley. Mohenjo-daro was built on a plateau to deal with unpredictable river flooding. To allow easy movement, city streets were divided into squares. Houses had shops were built within these squares. To protect its citizens, a citadel or a fortress was built in the center of the city. I have shown you a picture of the scene. Mohenjo-daro had a heated religious pool, storage facilities for crops. Many places you can in fact get to see the granaries wherein this you could store the grains. Plenty of them been recovered from number of these sites. Two storage buildings. In fact, in places the evidence is in favor of three storage buildings. So it was quite an involved kind of an architecture as such. Made up of mud bricks, defensive towers and sewer system. They had a written language. Unfortunately, it is through symbols and we have still not been able to understand that particular language. But there is a script, pictograph, sign that expresses a thought or idea. So basically some more amount of work is needed to understand what was the language and what is the script basically. Next. So this is actually a picture based on whatever the ruins that have been studying. This is a picture created by an artist. This must have been sort of a city with a proper sewerage system, you can see over here. And these are the houses. So this is a sort of an idealized kind of a picture created by an artist, but that is based on whatever material that has been recovered from these archaeological sites. Next. So Mohenjo-daro, I'm just going to show you some pictures. So that is the citadel, a view of the citadel from different directions. Next. The aerial photography, and you can see a very well-planned kind of a city with proper roads, with proper sort of a aeration between two houses. There's a proper sort of a place that has been kept. And even water cooling systems also did exist during that particular period. Next. Water supply. Harappani was by and large is an arid and semi-arid region. So something like Nagar, the present day Nagar, we have a very least amount of rainfall that the place received. 700 millimeters to 100 millimeters per annum. It decreased from east to west, while winter precipitation from 200 to 50 or less from west to east, and summer temperature soaring above 40 degrees Celsius. Run of Kutch, for example, the Dholavira part, if you look at there, the temperatures always are in excess of 40 degrees centigrade presently. Harappans excelled in raising water structures in a wide variety and were the first to exploit groundwater by sinking a well. Water exploitation and management should have been of great concern at Harappa. So in fact, today we speak about water conservation structures. We speak in terms of rainwater harvesting. But in fact, it is the reinventing the way. People knew that particular system 1,000 years before. Next. The Great Bath, which is basically a water reservoir, is the earliest public water tank used for baptizing babies. Like the drains, the tightly fitted bricks and the tar on the inside of the bath was used to make it waterproof. The only way the water could escape was through a special system. It also has a plug hole which was used for totally emptying out the bath. And the dimension was basically 12 meters long and 7 meters wide. Next. And these are the pictures of the Great Bath, and this you can see this is the plug from where you can drain out the entire water vessel. So these are some of the very well developed sort of engineering marvels, you can call them as, and they existed some few thousand years before time. So it was a very sort of a evolved kind of a civilization. Next. Streets I already have spoken about, we'll just run through them. Next. And these are some of the wells. Private wells were rebuilt over many generations for large households and neighborhoods. It looks like a chimney, but actually during the excavation, the surrounding soil has been removed. So that is the reason it gives an impression that it is a chimney, because actually it is a well. Okay. And there are smaller sort of a tanks wherein they used to store water. Next. And you can see these are pictures coming from Dholavira. This is a water reservoir in Dholavira. In fact, there is a proper system to get down, to climb down into the reservoir. In fact, within the reservoir, there is another small sort of a water storage system to keep water cool, in fact. And then, this is coming from basically the local part, wherein you can see basically the wells that are still well preserved. Next.
Not mine. Huh? Okay. Anyway. Okay. Next. Okay. Sorry,
Sorry for the interruption, it was some technical. So water storage and supply structures in ancient days of Indus civilization. In fact, you can see water transportation used to happen through the tunnels, underground water transportation. In fact, both the drainage were covered and transportation of water also, not like the present day open system, but it is a covered system. So they were quite health conscious, hygienic people. Next. So there are plenty such structures being seen at different levels. In fact, these are the same pictures of the reservoir from different angles. And this is basically the water transportation system. That's the well that we have. Next. And that is actually very, because this is Dholavira is in the run of Kutch, full of sand. So many times there can be collapsing that can happen from the sideways. To avoid that, there is a proper sort of a lining of bricks. So they knew like how to protect the water structures. Next. And in fact, they did construct dams also. They were called as gabarbans, or stone-built dams construction designed to control and store water, probably used for irrigation, having dated from the early Harappan period or Code Digi phase, which is 2800 to 2600 BC. Next. You can ponder at this particular structure wherein the water has been kept much deeper. So it's a water cooling system basically. So that's not actually a well. Water from the other well is actually diverted into such a hole. So it is going into the deeper part and gets cooled as such. So this kind of a cooling system also did exist. And there is a proper sort of a, you can get to see a staircase to go down to collect the water. Next. There is evidence of very sophisticated drainage systems. Sewage and drainage were composed by complex networks, especially in Harappa. Latrines, soak pits, cesspools, pipes and channels were the main elements of wastewater disposal. In fact, stormwater drains also did exist during that particular part. It was recorded that urban flows of the Harappan period had two types of wastewater system, namely the centralized and the decentralized system. In fact, like the manhole that we speak of, the actual beginning of the manhole has been seen during that civilization. So all your drainages are coming at one common point from where, from a hole you can get into, and if there is any choking, you can remove that choke. Next. These toilets were of two tiles made of clay bricks with a seat or consisting of a simple hole in the ground. The effluent were directed to pits made of clay bricks. In fact, many times I always wonder that especially the toilets within which all that waste that is excreta that we leave, so that must be stinking and all that. But the reasons are such, one is a cold desert and second being basically a hot desert lake. And wherein a very simple system even today also exists. Just a cow dung, or else perhaps what you have is the ponies and pony dung that gets spread over the shit so that immediately the stinking stops. And this is what they are practicing today also. Okay. So probably those kind of practices did exist during even that culture. The effluent were directed to pits made up of clay bricks. In order to prevent the drainage system from getting clogged, pits were located at the junction of several drains or in certain places where the drains extended over a long distance. These pits were treated as manholes, as I mentioned about. And mostly their locations, if you look at, they are in the square part of it, like the present day. So, next. And they are all covered basically. Make a record that in order to reduce the friction of the water on the walls, vents were curved using key bricks.
Almost every house was connected to a sewer system and centralized wastewater collection was used at Harappa. Next. So this is basically, you can see a 5 to 6 meter deep sort of a structure wherein all the sewerage used to get connected and get treated out there. So sewerage treatment system did exist during that particular time. And this is a very complex sort of a drainage structure, both open and in certain areas very covered one. Okay, next. These are the pictures coming from the Lowell region, and as I mentioned about Lowell is a dockyard which to an extent had a connectivity with the sea, and through the ship basically the business used to happen with mostly the Euphrates River. Next. Dholavara is an exception within the Harappan culture, both in its architecture and the management of water resources. In addition to the raw bricks and terracotta, stones were widely used. This is another basically for building the walls of the houses and the fortification of the city. If you look at Dholavara, there is hardly any soil that is available in the close vicinity. It is full of sands. And therefore, they made use of rocky material in constructing many of their houses. So as compared to the other city area like Dholavara, the Mohenjo-daro and Harappa, wherein a proper sort of a material has been used to make the bricks, and proper brick structures exist in that part, here actually it is a combination of rocks and brick material. Next. So this is the lower part, and this is what I was telling you about the dock. There are pictures. Present day also you can see that these ships used to get parked in those docks. Next. And this is what? This is the dockyard. You can see presently also filled up with water, and that is the artist's creation, the picture. And from there you can actually get into the main sea. So from there there is an entry happening. In fact, you can get to see, there are pictures also showing you the entry part of the ship into that dockyard. Next. Then stormwater drains also. And these are, although filled in with silt today, but actually excess water during flooding can be removed from the city part or the villages through these stormwater drains. And they were seen located at the various gates. So these are the Dholavara stormwater drainage system. Here it is quite clear now, you can see. So the excess water can drain through and beneath the ground only. It can get drained from the city part as such. Next. These are a few more pictures of the same Dholavara stormwater drainage system. Next. So it was estimated that the Harappan villa is invaded by the early 1700 BC. No one is sure why their civilization ended. Perhaps invaders or natural disaster caused the civilization to collapse. From my understanding, basically, there are certain amount of geological evidences in favor. Basically, you can see the very creation of Ranakkach is very recent times, like. About says, means there are stories wherein in 300 times basically, 300 means after the Christ basically, you had a sort of a proper sort of a navigation happening, but presently it is all run of Kutch. So there is, the entire thing has been elevated as such. So probably there could be some geological divisions, perhaps Rajguru sir can show better work on this. This is what I noticed, especially in the run of Kutch part as such, where the Dholavara to a great extent got completely perished. Perhaps invaders of natural disaster caused the civilization to collapse. Next. Thank you for the patient listening.
In fact, मागे जर गेलात ना ते सरस्वतीवर एक होतं, त्याच्यात एक लिंक होती सरस्वती म्हणून, एक दुसऱ्या किंवा तिसऱ्या ह्याच्यात असेल. त्याचं हायपरलिंक आहे, मला माहीत नाही उघडेल की नाही. पहिला पेनड्राईव्ह आहे ना इकडे.
So when we speak about Indus, basically another interesting part is the Saraswati. Where the Saraswati is located, where is it lost? So I have some pictures, I'll just try to.
Mandar ke institute madhe jaat ya atne udate ppt. Go next. हां सरस्वती नाही, यू विल हॅव टू ओपन द एंटायर. इनेबल डिस्प्ले ऑन द
ओके. सो दिस इज व्हाट द पालियो सरस्वती रिवर सिस्टम, which is basically again emanated from your Indus river as such, and presently you can see basically it has drained into the Punjab region in basically in the very close to Chandigarh. The present day Ghaggar river system is there, so that looks to be the hidden Saraswati as such. Next. So this is the present day Ghaggar river, which is on. There are many evidences, both archaeological as well as geological, that indicate it is basically a part of or remnant of your Saraswati. Next. This is a paleo channel. I mean, although you can see on the surface there is plenty of sand as such, but if you dig say around 3.5 meters, 4 meters, you get plenty of water. Okay, so that is how a paleo channel normally operates. Next. So this is what we had suggested for the border security force when they are facing the severe water shortage. So we drilled a well in that, and you can see into the next picture. This is the plenty of water that came out. So all along that paleo channel, in fact, there are, you can locate in any place you can locate your well and take out the water. Okay, next. So the traditional rainwater harvesting systems, basically these are pictures from both Punjab and there are few from Rajasthan. Next. Okay, and this is just a comparison. This is the ancient system of Dhalavira, and what has been seen even today also in Rajasthan in certain areas. Next. So it's been divided into number of sectors: mountainous rain shadow region like Spiti Valley of Himalaya. Next. Then flood zones to check flood during monsoons: West Bengal, Bihar and Uttar Pradesh. Next. And the third part, that is our part basically, the Deccan Plateau, which is only monsoon fed non-perennial river systems. Next. And then the desert and arid region of Rajasthan, that is the rim of Kutch basically, and wherein presently what kind of the systems are in operation, water conservation structures, and probably you can compare them what we have seen during the Harappan civilization. Next. One more part, that is mountain region with heavy rainfall to check erosion and to provide water in non-raining months, since water distribution systems are not easy to install. Next. So this is a centuries old cool irrigation in the western Himalaya, mountainous rain shadow region like Spiti Valley, and this is actually water coming from where glaciers, a straightaway springs basically, and that has been diverted through such channels which are called as cools and get stored over there. They laid into a tank in the village from which water flows is regulated. This is what is the present system, and present is key to the past. That is what geologists believe. So we have learned many things from the past. Next. These are basically the in the Bengal part where you have excessive water and where you have basically the The silty region where the plenty of groundwater is available at a very shallow depth, and therefore there can be excessive flooding happening. So these are called as inundation channels. Flood water enters the fields through the inundation channels. The water is brought in the rich silt and fish both. The fish feed on mosquito larvae and help check malaria in this region. Next. So this is what is the present day system in operation in the Bengal part. Next. These are called the khadims of Jaisalmer in the Rajasthan part. They are designed by the Paliwal Brahmins of Jaisalmer in the 15th century. Similar system also practiced in Iraq, the Negev desert, and in southwest Colorado. An embankment prevents water from flowing away. Here you can see, in fact, the construction of a small wall out there. Collected water seeps into the soil and it acts as a percolation tank also, so that the groundwater system gets replenished and the aquifers get replenished. Next. These are Jowars of Rajasthan, again another structure, Ardhanar Masnari, which is the rain harvesting structure. Next. These are a close up of the Jowars of Rajasthan. Next. And this is what the Tankas are becoming. In fact, you can see, since there is an excessive evaporation, because this is the Rajasthan part, so to avoid that, the water is stored underneath, and these are basically the pathways through which waters enter into this plant. So this is what is the present system, and probably the engineering part of this we understood through our ancient civilizations. Next. Next. So that is, those are the pipes from the rooftop lead rainwater into the Tanka catchment, and note the slope provided for the rainwater Palar Pani to flow into the Tanka. Next. Next. Many pictures of those. Next. Rainwater harvesting in Rajasthan today, and that is your Indira Gandhi Nahar. So through which, in fact, the Yamuna water is entered into Rajasthan Canal Indira Gandhi Nahar project brings water. But in fact, that has created certain issues also. There is a lots of solar fluxion and the salt in great extent, which was in excess in the seas, has come up now, and this basically has become a waterlogged area. So the fertile land has become barren or bad land, so that. Next. In the Deccan Plateau, no perennial rivers, and what is the system that is in operation? Next. 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 So these are basically from the northeastern stages, where how the water transportation happens. They are made use of the bamboos basically for transportation of water. Next. And you can see basically these bamboos from where the spring water is diverted in and accordingly then brought to the city or small villages as bamboo drip irrigation in Meghalaya. So most of these understanding probably has come from our ancient civilization. This is what I wanted to impress upon you. Next. Next. Yeah. Next. Yeah. Thank you. Thank you.
Impressed me or appeal me. That is what I wanted to share with you.
Thanks, sir. We can allow one or two queries or comments, if any. Okay. So, on behalf of all of you and the Institute and myself, I would like to propose a vote of thanks for the speech delivered just now by the Honorable Vice Chancellor, Professor Nitin Karmarkar. The speech was indeed extremely informal and informative. So putting both the things together is a very difficult thing. And I would not imagine a vice chancellor of a university talking for about 50 minutes on a hand mic. And he was really engrossed in that and he did that. We are really thankful to you, sir.
But I still conduct lectures every morning.
Yeah, even that is a difficult situation for a position that you are holding. We have in the audience many dignitaries and scholars. We have Professor Rajguru, as mentioned by Professor Karmalkar. We also have Dr. Arun Chandra Pathak, the ex-secretary and executive editor of the Gazetteers of the Maharashtra State. We have Professor Raja Deekshit and many professors and teachers from the university, which is headed by Professor Karmalkar. I'm also thankful to the friends of Professor Karmalkar, who are members of this institute, particularly Mr. Girish Kale and Mr. Mohan Pitambare, and also member of the executive board of the institute, Professor Sudhir Vaishampayan, who had a major part in arrangement of this particular function. And I'm thankful to all of you sitting in the audience for making this function a success, as also the leaders and workers of the Vidya Prasarak Mandal Thane, who have arranged to telecast this particular function live as a webinar. And I'm also thankful to you, sir, for your patience during the technical fault. So thank you. With the permission of the authorities, I declare that the function is concluding. Thank you.